together, to hear your word, to sing songs of praise, to share in the sacrament of Holy Communion. Help us to remember, Lord, in all things, at all times and all places, that not only are you our very present help in time of need, but you are our shelter, and you are our rock, and you are our refuge. So lead us, guide us, have mercy on us, O God. For it is your Son's name that we make this prayer. Amen. Our opening hymn is, Be Still and Know That I Am God. Be Still, My Soul, 534 in the hymnal. Would you stand if you're able? We come to a time of sharing our joys and concerns and God sightings. Are there joys or concerns or God sightings that you would like to lift up? Elaine?
She's got 2 weeks to 2 months, so okay. Please cover her in prayer.
So Jean, and also is it Linda?
Linda.
Linda Allen and Jean. Thank you.
Update on my brother. He came home last Tuesday. He says that he feels like a Mack truck ran over him, but other than that, he says he's doing pretty good, and so please continue prayers for his recovery.
What's your brother's first name? Danny? Others? Joys? Concerns? God sightings? Well, I want to thank everybody that came and all the kitchen staff and Ron, who very ably kept things going with getting the food out and figuring out, communicating who needed what and getting that done. It was just really joyful. It was an awesome time of fellowship, I think, and really good food. And I'm grateful for your willingness to try something new mixed in with something old, and it was good. And I would also say that our Bake with the Bible class just continues to be a joy, even though we were missing two very special people yesterday. Just the time together, and then being able to share a little bit, eating together, the fellowship, helping each other, just really special. And every Saturday I go home and just think about it. And so I'm grateful for that too. Are there any others, joys or concerns or God sightings? Yay, it is. Some of us just came out without our winter coats on. So two things that, while they might be announcement worthy, I want to share these as joys, assuming I can get there. I do not often, let me do it this way. Now, give me a second. I get a lot of emails from Mission Central, and I don't ordinarily do anything much with them because, well, I don't know about you, but I get an overload of emails, and that's not getting me where I wanted to go. Update on medical supplies headed for Ukraine. I wanted to share this with you. This is from a post from early this morning. It says, in addition to continuing to pray for those in the Ukraine, we want to give you an update of the medical supplies en route to Ukraine. On Friday morning, we received a call from Tatiana, who was looking for medical items to send to Ukraine through Word of Life Baptist Church. Thanks to your support, Mission Central was able to supply many of the things that she needed. These items included gauze pads, medical dressings, antiseptic treatment, alcohol pads, adult diapers, catheters, masks, isolation gowns, syringes, Tylenol and flu medications, sutures, medical needles, and more. She and her husband arrived with a cargo van on Friday, shortly after we finished sorting and packing. As we were loading medical supplies into their van, they shared stories of those living in Ukraine now and what is going on. They told of homes being bombed, individuals sitting in bunkers for over a week, nursing home challenges, mothers giving birth underground, and people who ran out of their homes with nothing more than what they had on. We saw pictures of empty grocery store shelves and saw the devastation of war. After we loaded, they took the items to be sorted and labeled in Ukrainian so they'd be able to enter the country. Saturday evening, those supplies left the United States for Poland via airplane so they could be driven into Ukraine and immediately distributed to those in need. And for now, they're collecting Band-Aids, gauze rolls and pads, adhesives and non-adhesive dressing, wound treatments, alcohol swabs, and also you can make a monetary donation. And I will double-check this, but I'm sure with Mission Central, similar to UMCOR, that if you send a monetary donation earmarked for medical supplies for Ukraine, that's where it will go. I will verify that, though, because I know that's important to me. But I think it's exciting to know in a situation where we all reasonably feel helpless, at least indirectly, we are helping. And how wonderful that help in needed supplies can happen that quickly. So I wanted to share that with you. And on a related note, we also get a lot of mail that I think qualifies as junk mail. We get so much, I don't know what to do with it. That's why the desk is always covered. I look at it and I'm like, do I dare throw this away? This is from the food pantry. And it's a very generic card, but I think this is important. They had handwritten at top, Friends at East Canton United Methodist Church. Thank you for your donation to the Canton Food Pantry. Your contribution is a living example of neighbors helping neighbors. Many thanks from the Canton Area Food Pantry team. And then at the bottom, they have written, fourth quarter 2021, 67 items donated. I believe with rising gas prices that food prices are going to begin to going up and up and up. And so your donations, our donations to the food pantry are going to be that much more meaningful and needed because the poor will become poorer in the situation as they have to make decisions about, do I buy gas or do I buy food? Do I buy food for my pet or food for my family? Do I pay for prescriptions? So neighbors helping neighbors, thank you for your commitment to the food pantry. And anytime you have something extra, just bring it in and we'll get it to them. But I think that is a joy, and I think that is a God sighting, and I think it is a prayer. Would you join me in a spirit of prayer? And our prayer song, when I get back to the right page. Oh, how he loves you and me. Please feel free to raise your voice in prayer.
Lord, please be with Jean over the next few weeks. Comfort her. Cover her with your care. Let her be ever mindful how much you love her. And be with Linda, Lord. She will be going for some results, and it doesn't sound like they're going to be real good results. So cover her with your care, too. Let her feel your presence and your arms around her.
Yes, Lord. God, we're so thankful for signs of spring. We're so thankful to see the grass, even if it's brown. We're so thankful for the warmth of the sun and a day when we can just be out without coats and start to think about planting, even just simple little things like pepper plants and tomato plants. And we're just so thankful for your love and for your love demonstrated in this congregation. Be present with us and guide us. We pray, Lord, for peace for the world. We pray for all those who are struggling and suffering. We pray for an end to this conflict, to this horrible, horrible thing that's happening in the Ukraine. We pray for world peace. We pray for humility on the part of the world's leaders. And we pray, Lord, for your guidance and your direction for us as individuals, for us as church, for us as part of a community. We lift up to you all those members of our congregation and our extended families who are struggling with health issues. We ask your blessing on those who are visiting with families this weekend. And we pray for those who just are not able to get around as well as they used to. Lead us as a people. Help us to be mindful of your presence with us and your gift of love that is in this place. Give us creative ways to share it, O God. So we also ask your blessing on all those who will be attending and participating in the upcoming Lenten luncheons this week, both in Canton and Troy. Have mercy on us, O God, for it is in your Son's name that we make this prayer. Amen. Okay. So the scriptures for today are Isaiah 58 and Luke chapter 4, verses 1 to 13. Isaiah 58. I won't read all of this because it is kind of long, but I have a very special affinity for this text. Isaiah 58 page 906, young friends, 906 in your Bibles. Isaiah, shout it aloud, do not hold back. Raise your voice like a trumpet. Declare to my people their rebellion and to the descendants of Jacob their sins. For day after day they seek me out. They seem eager to know my ways as if they were a nation that does what is right and has not forsaken the commands of its God. They ask me for just decisions and seem eager for God to come near them. Why have we fasted, they say, and you have not seen it? Why have we humbled ourselves and you have not noticed? Yet on your day of fasting, you do as you please. You exploit all your workers. Your fasting ends in quarreling and strife and in striking each other with wicked fists. You cannot fast as you do today and expect your voice to be heard on high. That ought to scare us all. Is this the kind of fast I have chosen? Only a day for people to humble themselves? Is it only for bowing one's head like a reed and for lying in sackcloth and ashes? Is that what you call a fast, a day acceptable to the Lord? Is not this the kind of fasting I have chosen? To loose the chains of injustice, to untie the cords of the yoke, to set the oppressed free and break every yoke? Is it not to share your food with the hungry, to provide the poor wanderer with shelter, when you see the naked to clothe them, and not to turn away from your own flesh and blood? Then your light will break forth like the dawn, and your healing will quickly appear. Then your righteousness will go before you, and the glory of the Lord will be your rear guard. Then you will call, and the Lord will answer. You will cry for help, and he will say, here am I. If you do away with the yoke of oppression, with the pointing of finger and malicious talk, and if you spend yourselves in behalf of the hungry and satisfy the needs of the oppressed, then your light will rise in the darkness, and your night will become like the noonday. The Lord will guide you always, and he will satisfy your needs in a sun-scorched land and will strengthen your frame. You will be like a well-watered garden, like a spring whose waters never fail. Your people will rebuild the ancient ruins and will rise up the age-old foundations. You will be called repairer of broken walls and restorer of streets with dwellings. May God add God's blessing to the reading and hearing of this word. And then Luke chapter 4, verses 1 to 13. And that is on page 1295. Page 1295. The Gospel of Jesus Christ from Luke's Gospel. This is right after the baptism of Jesus by John in the River Jordan. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, left the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and at the end of them he was hungry. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, 'Man shall not live on bread alone.'" The devil led him up to a high place and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And he said to him, "I will give you all their authority and splendor. It has been given to me, and I can give it to anyone I want to. If you worship me, it will all be yours." Jesus answered, "It is written, 'Worship the Lord your God and serve him only.'" The devil led him to Jerusalem and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. "If you are the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down from here, for it is written, 'He will command his angels concerning you to guard you carefully. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone.'" Jesus answered, "It is said, 'Do not put the Lord your God to the test.'" When the devil had finished all this tempting, he left him until an opportune time. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Would you pray with me? Oh, holy God, be present with us as we wrestle and reflect and wonder. Speak to our hearts. Help us to recognize your presence in each other, in the breaking of the bread, in your words, O God. Have mercy on us and lead us. For it is in your Son's name that we make this prayer. Amen. So I want to tell you a little story first about the reading from Isaiah and why I said it was very near to my heart. Somewhere, and it might have been in actually our Bake with the Bible class the other week, I talked about being hangry. You know what hangry is? It's when you get hungry and angry. You're angry because you're hungry, and you're just sort of like, this is the way I used to be when I would run out of sugar stuff in the house, because I've got 20 sweet teeth, all of them, not just one sweet tooth, but all of them love sugar. And I've cut way back on that now, but I could feel it. It just, you know, I had to have a cookie. I had to have something, and if there was nothing left in the house that was going to satisfy that, I would either get a little grumpy. Me? I would get a little grumpy, or I would go to the store and get a bag of Oreos. But many years ago, I was trying to fast, and really, you know, I joke about being grumpy. I'm as human as the next person, but usually with me, what you see is what you get. I'm not any different at home. I've been with you in a variety of situations, and I think I'm fairly consistent. You don't usually see me slamming cabinet doors and throwing things around. But this particular time, many, many years ago, I was trying to do a very strict fast, not giving up chocolate for Lent, which would have probably not worked anyway, but I was trying to go without food and just drink a little juice. And I was getting grumpy and grumpy and grumpy, and I wasn't able to hide it. And so I did that time-honored tradition of Bible roulette. Anybody know what Bible roulette is? I don't recommend it as a general practice. I think as an occasional practice, it can be helpful, but I think it's something that can be overdone. So if you're not sure what I'm talking about, Bible roulette is you just sort of ask God to guide you, maybe, and you just sort of open the Bible and say, that's God's word for me today. You know, just point to your finger. And Well, that day, I decided to play Bible roulette, and what do you think the page was? Isaiah 58. And the lines could have been written in bold print that said, "Fasting like yours today will never make you make your voice heard on high." I broke my fast. It made a really big impression. So on to the rest of this. If you're going on a trip, would you say that you are a light packer? That is, you just strictly take exactly what you need and nothing more? Or are you a contingency packer because you just might need that extra 5 shirts or another 2 sweaters or a different... Anybody like that? I am a contingency packer. When I was going to Massachusetts in October, just for fun, I sent Ruth a picture of the back of our car. Now, there were 2 women, and computers and books and research and clothes, and I can't get out of the house without that, just that one more thing. Jesus, after his baptism, was led, some translations say driven, by the Holy Spirit into the wilderness for 40 days. And 40 days of being tempted. Now, each of the Gospels tell the story a little differently. One of them says after 40, I forget which one, but it's not Luke, after 40 days of fasting and prayer, the devil came and tempted him. But Luke said he was tempted for 40 days. And I think there is a difference that's not even subtle. Because in your life and mine, how much temptation can we stand up under before we buckle, before we cave? How much stress can we take before we just throw up our hands and say, "I give up, that's it"? To be tested and tempted by Satan for 40 days while praying and fasting, but still. And Luke doesn't tell us what he took. I mean, Jesus didn't say, "Hold on a minute, Holy Spirit, let me get my favorite tunic. Let me get a scripture to bring along with me. Let me get my tools in case I get bored." He just went, ostensibly with the clothes on his back and nothing else, trusting in God, his Father, to provide for him and knowing that he would be fasting. Fasting is an important spiritual discipline. It can be an aid to prayer, and it is always designed to enable us to grow closer to God by stepping away from some things or one thing. I would say if you were going to try the fast like I did, some people when they fast, they do without all food and just a little bit of fruit juice, because you are a steward of your own body. So you can't not drink something. The idea of fasting is not to make you sick, but to enable you to just give up whatever might hold you back, to allow you to grow closer to God. But fasting can also be what many of us do for Lent, giving up that one thing. And that one thing can be really tough. And I would say the reason we do that is to connect with the story that we have of Jesus fasting and praying in the wilderness and going through this time of temptation. Now, all of us experience temptation. And all of us sin. One of the things that I appreciate about the story of Jesus going through this in the wilderness is even though the temptations that Satan threw at him were God-sized, they were directed to his identity as the Son of God, to his identity as God, as one who had the power to do the very things that Satan was tempting him with. And one of the things that underscores for me is how very individualized temptations are. Now, you might have a friend, maybe a spouse or a friend or a relative that you were so close to that you were comfortable talking about the temptations that you battle. But in general, they're pretty personal, aren't they? They are pretty personal and not the stuff of everyday conversation or ordinary conversation. But when I look at stories of Jesus being tempted and how the temptations that Satan threw at him were tailor-made for him, it makes sense to me that the things that tempt me are tailor-made for me and might not bother any of you at all, or, you know, I think that's important. The writer of Hebrews says, and I'm not going to give you chapter and verse because I didn't look it up, but I know that the writer of Hebrews says that we can take confidence that we do not have a God who, that Jesus went through temptation just like we do. That Jesus understood in his own being, in his own body, what it was to be tempted. And that because we have a God who went through this, we know we can trust him in prayer. Now, this is freely translated, but that makes a really big difference to me. Because, and maybe to you, because if you're going through a struggle, so maybe not a temptation, but think about, for instance, breast cancer survivors. How wonderful is it when somebody has been diagnosed with breast cancer to have someone from the Cancer Society who has been through that reach out and contact and support? It makes a difference. Sometimes we, without meaning to be flip, we will say to somebody, well, I know just what you're going through. And you can never know what another person feels. But to have someone come to you and offer you support when they have been through similar circumstances and they're supporting you, not, you know, just sort of dismissing your struggles, can make a big difference in being able to navigate those waters. So I think that we can relate to the story of Jesus going through these sufferings in very personal ways, not because we have fasted from food for 40 days, not because we've had God-sized temptations, but we are tempted and we often fail. So what did Jesus take with him into the wilderness then, if it wasn't an extra set of clothes or any other thing you can think of? Jesus, the text tells us, went into the wilderness filled with the Holy Spirit. And Jesus did not just rely on the fact that he was God and that he was the Son of God, but he relied on the strength of the Holy Spirit, the spiritual discipline of fasting and prayer and drawing close to God. And interestingly, when push came to shove, when those temptations that Luke mentions, and they're the same temptations that are mentioned in Matthew and Mark and John, Jesus used Scripture. Jesus used Scripture to push back against Satan. And the scriptures that Jesus used are all from Deuteronomy, from the Old Testament. So the first one was, I turn back to Isaiah. Yeah. The first one was the temptation to turn stone to bread. And Jesus' response was, it is written, you shall not live by bread alone. And the rest of that quote is, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. So then the temptation to worship, he said, you should worship the Lord your God and him alone. And there was another one here. There's a reason that I think this is important. Worship the Lord your God alone. And then when Satan took him to the top of the temple, I thought it was interesting that Jesus allowed himself to be taken to the top of the temple and stand there. So he endured, he put up with the temptation. But when Satan said, you know, just throw yourself down from here because your angels are going to protect you. And Jesus' response was, do not put the Lord your God to the test. And Satan left him, when he'd finished all this tempting, left him for an opportune time. And every time I read those words, I find it chilling. I find it chilling, knowing that Satan was going to come back at Jesus at another weak moment, at least, you know, supposedly weak moment. Jesus' reliance on Scripture wasn't proof texting, and it wasn't just something he had memorized. Now, Jesus is God. And he was there. But what I think is important is that Satan was throwing a pack of lies at Jesus, and Jesus was responding not just with the letter of the law, but with the spirit of the law, with the spirit of God's word, about not putting God to the test, about worshiping God alone. And living not by bread alone. One of the things that I find important about this, besides our personal connection, is that in the 40 days in the wilderness, Jesus was, in a sense, also mirroring the experience of ancient Israel 40 years in the wilderness, and every test that Jesus experienced, that he passed, was something that Israel in the wilderness had failed to do. God gave them manna because they complained and complained. They didn't wait to see what God's plan was going to be for feeding them. They got panicky and grumpy and hangry. And so God said, all right, I'm going to give you manna. But here's the deal. Every day it will rain down on the ground, and you will go out in the morning and collect it, but only enough for the day, daily bread. And I think that is as important a connection to what Jesus was doing and experiencing, because he also in that was showing us how we can deal with temptation. You've heard me often remind us that in our baptismal promises, we promise to accept the freedom and power God gives us to refuse, reject evil in all of its forms. And saying that, if we ask God to help us, if we ask God to give us the strength, God will. The big question is, will we receive it? Will we accept it? Will we draw on the strength that God gives us to stop ourselves in the middle of temptation, to stop ourselves as we are ready to, you know, fill in the blank, steal, gossip, lie, murder, defame, whatever things we might be tempted to do, are we willing to accept the power of the Holy Spirit that is in us? Because you and I could say, well, it was easy for Jesus. He was God. But look at the extreme situation that Jesus was in, having no food, probably very little water, being tempted over and over and over again, and having his identity as God's son just slammed in his face and twisted around. If you are the Son of God, if you really are the Son of God, then you can do this and it'll be fine. There's no wonder that Satan is called the father of liars, because that's what all the temptations were lies, lies, lies. But Jesus, and we're certainly not God, but like Jesus, you and I have received the Holy Spirit in our baptism, the Spirit who is present with us. When we ask God, when we ask Jesus to come into our hearts, Jesus doesn't leave the Father and Holy Spirit behind. God comes to us. And God will give us the strength. Now, we might better prefer that God just remove the temptation. I think, even having lost weight, I think one of the hardest things, maybe a couple of really hard things to do, are dealing with addictions for alcohol and drugs and even smoking. And I think probably giving up smoking has got to be one of the most challenging things. It's not easy. It's not easy. Wouldn't it be nice if God just took all that away instead of choosing to help us turn our backs, help us overcome, help us say no, help us be stronger? Personally, strength, no temptation, I'd rather not have to deal. But that's not how this works. So I just want to share those things with you because I think they're important. What do we do with daily bread? What do we do with daily bread? In the wilderness, the people were taught to rely on God's provision. And it was really important that God was asking them to just trust him to feed them every day and not take more than they needed. And how Jesus is our daily bread, I can't say I have that totally figured out, but I think it's important. And what happens when we come together at the Lenten lunch this week, for those of you who are going at both the Lenten lunches, you're going to be sitting most likely with other believers, because I don't think too many non-believers go to those things. So you're going to be in the company of other saints who love God, maybe approach God from different ways than you do. But what happens at that table? Because even not being communion, when we sit down and fellowship and eat together and acknowledge God's gifts and God's presence in each of us, something happens. Something happens. As we transition to the sacrament of Holy Communion, I'd like to invite you to watch this video.
Been doing it that way up until this last time. I just felt like changing it all of a sudden. I don't know why. I don't know why. Okay. Tempo. Breaking bread, we are gathered here together to break bread. Breaking bread, breaking bread, we are gathered here together to break bread. It's not the barley or the wheat, it's not the oven or the heat that makes this bread so good to eat. It's the kneading and the sharing that makes the meal complete. Breaking bread, breaking bread, we are gathered here together to break bread. Breaking bread, breaking bread, we are gathered here together to break bread. Upon the water bread is cast, the last is first, the first is last. For everyone who eats this bread, there are thousands, maybe more, that will be fed. Breaking bread, breaking bread, we are gathered here together to break bread. Breaking bread, breaking bread, we are gathered here together to break bread. Breaking bread, breaking bread, we are gathered here together to break bread.
Your hymnals to page 12 and 13, to a service of word and table. We'll be page 12 and 13 in your hymnal. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin, and who seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will.
We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors.
And we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. If you have confessed your sins to God, then I say to you, in the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. And on page 13, the Great Thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join in their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for you, he took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. Again, he gave you thanks and praise, gave the cup to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and juice. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. The table, amen. The table is prepared, or at least almost, if you would give Ruth and me a chance to get set up down there, and then I invite you to come. Lorraine, the body of Christ broken for you. Oh God, nourish us with this bread and remind us of the blessing of your provision for us in all that we do, all that we eat. Keep us mindful, God, of the needs of others, and keep us mindful that you are the bread of our life, the central, most important thing. We make this prayer in the name of your Son, Jesus the Christ. We come to a time to bless the offering of God, to bless our gifts and offer them to God. Gracious God, everything we have is your gift to us, and we offer back to you a portion of those blessings. Receive these offerings from the hands of your children, your servants, and multiply them for your use and service to your kingdom. As we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples, our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory. Amen.
Our closing hymn is number 377, It Is Well With My Soul.
Thank you.
If you can stay even long enough to decorate two sticks, I welcome you to join us downstairs. Wherever you find yourselves this day, may you walk in God's grace and God's mercy and the assurance of God's love for you. And may the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you this day and remain with you always. Amen. Thank you. Those are the books. I've got to get my microphone off. Okay.